Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you. You are a living God. You sent Jesus to walk among your people, humanity, and he died on the cross. But dying and suffering, he was buried. But on the third day, he was risen again. And that's the joy that I know that you are love. Christ is the joy of our salvation. And you sent the Holy Spirit to dwell among us, to help us as we are traveling through this road of upside down and challenges of the virus and a lot of different things that are going on around us. And we praise you, Father, and I thank you that for all of my brothers and sisters here. And I pray for them all, and I thank you for watching over them, all of us. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Amen. Thank you so much, Rita. This is a time to share from your own journey. And I know a few of you have not been with us in a while, and we would like to know more. I'm going to put again Rita on the spot here. We missed you, Rita. Every Wednesday night, she would write to me and say, still recovering, feeling better, but not fully recovered. So if you would be kind, and as much as you would like to share with the family that had missed you here for a while, would you share with us, please?
Yes, it was a challenging time, a whole month, not being able to do anything. I was very fortunate, though, that I didn't get the cough or the fever. It was just the virus just brought me down, not able to eat very much. I drank a lot of liquids to make sure I was hydrated. But just sleeping and not even able to have my eyes open to read my Bible, or, you know, that was, to me, thinking about it, the saddest part of not being able to have that connection like I normally am, praising God and thanking him for everything. And, but I'm getting stronger, and I praise the Lord. I can be up for 3 hours before I have to take a rest.
Wow.
But yeah, but someone told me that it's going to take a while to be back to normal. And what is normal in this world?
Good question.
Mm.
Wow. Good to see you, Rita.
I like to share something with my church family. This week have been very challenging. I was diagnosed with COVID-19. Mm. I think the hardest part is staying isolated, not seeing my son. So I try to peep through back windows and just catch a glimpse of him, but that's all I can do. Shamel's dad was diagnosed too. Actually, he had the virus before, and then it just spread like wildfire. Within 2 days, I got it, and I knew something was wrong. You know, my body was not normal, and I had chills and fever, and so I tested, and on Christmas Eve, I was diagnosed with a positive test result. I'm okay. I'm thankful for, I don't think I had it really, really bad. My chills and fever went away in about 2 days. Mm-hmm. But then the fatigueness kept continuing. I couldn't sleep a lot, Rita. I couldn't sleep. Maybe I slept the most about 5 hours. I was awake all the time. Overall, I didn't lose the smell. I think my smell and taste, I think I lost about 20-25% of it, not totally. So I could eat and I've been pushing fluids and trying to, you know, not to lay down a lot because I don't want all the pneumonia setting in, you know. So I try to do when the sun is out, I wear a mask and put gloves on and, you know, just go into the backyard and, you know, walk for about 10 minutes and come back and come back to the room again. So, yeah, so I'm thankful that Shamel and Auntie Lilu and Shehan is safe. That's my biggest worry. I didn't mind getting sick. I was, you know, I told y'all before too, you know, I'm not worried about COVID, you know, but I'm very worried about Shehan. So, so that's the fear I had, you know, so I just prayed to God and left everything in his hand. So, so far, thank God, you know, everything's been great. I think tomorrow going to be my, eighth day or ninth day. So I have an appointment with the doctor in the morning. So they'll tell me what to do from there. So that's the eventful week I had.
Oh, gee.
Wow.
Lots of people for our prayer list, Pastor.
That's for sure.
It gets bigger and bigger.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I tend to look at the numbers too. You know, last weekend, Saturday and Sunday, there were 30,000 more cases in LA County. Loma Linda is full. We don't have beds. I have been attending some COVID meetings, one or two online. We are struggling to have beds. Kaiser is out of beds. So that's a struggle we have. So people need to stay indoors. Do not go to gather anything. And, you know, but I saw during the Christmas times, people were out there Christmas shopping and freeways were packed. And I was thinking, what are you guys doing? You had no idea. You know, people die like flies, which is very sad.
There's a new variant that just came through now, too.
Yeah, from England. Mm-hmm. England got a stronger virus. you know, there are some people who relapse with it, you know, in the sense they had COVID and then they relapsed, they got COVID again. Mm. So what I heard was the second time when you get it, it's like even worse than the first time. So... Yeah, so had to be very careful, Miss Rita. I know you'll be careful, but, you know, wash your hands, you know, like, and wear masks, stay away from people.
I heard just tonight that new strain is even worse than this one.
Right, right.
Easier to catch, they say.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Jivika, we're very grateful to hear your testimony. We also praise the Lord for allowing you, who are probably the better equipped to deal with this virus, both in terms of knowledge and training that you have by virtue of your medical profession, as well as by your health. You're solid and healthy and like a tank. So in a way, you're well prepared to deal with this. And also mentally, as you said before, you did mention that you're not afraid of this. And in a way, you have to attest in a practical way to those words. So praise the Lord for this. And I know that this journey will benefit not only you, but also your patients, your employees, those with whom you interact, and hopefully raise the awareness and also the level of responsibility. I think an awareness is by now universal. Pretty much everybody knows about this virus, but the responsibility varies a lot. Mm-hmm. Some people take it more seriously than others. And I think it has to be, reinforced, this sense of responsibility, mm-hmm. especially for those that may not react the same. I mean, we see Jivika here, Rita, we only see her after a month of suffering in silence. Mm-hmm. And so two people, the same virus, two different reactions. And some are not even able to say, you know, I've been recovered. So mm-hmm. those are some things that should really give us some pause. If there are some other additions from your own personal journey with the Lord over the past week or two, we are one day away from concluding this year. And maybe you want to encapsulate something more than just a week, but feel free to share with your church family some of the ways in which you experienced the Lord over the past several days.
I was really blessed, Pastor, by the Sabbath service that you had. It looks like you went through a lot of work to do that, and I appreciate it and applaud you for that. The only problem was that guy by the name of Ted Moore.
Yes, that was very nice.
I thought it was a very nice program.
Ted, you did a tremendous, stupendous job. You were actually the first one to record, and you saw how the production team was struggling to put everything in place with virtually anything that could have gone wrong. Technically wise, it did go wrong. So we were just accompanied by a very, very small group of kids, virtually, you know, my kids and Gideon, that was our team. Mm-hmm. And Jivika also, thank you for coming to record. It was a team effort, and Pastor Shifra put the script together, Pastor Mark put the backdrop together, and they were working against the time, so much pressure on them. So by the grace of God, the main purpose was to provide this platform to church families to come together and worship, even as we had all of the measures with distancing and, you know, sanitizing and all of that. At least when we put it all together and edited, it looked like we were yet again together.
I think our church is blessed with these young people, Faith and Caleb, Gideon, and all the rest of the people on the media. A lot of young people we have, and they're just fantastic. I love them all.
Yes, amen. And we're also blessed with the support and the wisdom of veterans like you, Ted, and the support and resources from church members. I'm just going to share my little encounter with the Lord. The text is here somewhere, but it's in the past week or so, I received a text message from a lovely church family who said, you know, throughout this year, having media ministries enabled us to have a church at home from a distance. And so we decided to support this with a handsome donation. And I'm not going to mention the number, but it's substantial. It virtually doubles what we've been able to raise in the past several years. So that was an encounter that brought tears to my eyes, because it testifies about how the Spirit works in the hearts of all of us as members of the same family. It's an organic family. It resonates. It's not like, oh, somebody does their thing there, somebody else does their thing there. It's like we're all together doing something, and one may be able to help one way, one another way. And I was overwhelmed. And today I met at the church with a family member who brought their donation, and it was a beautiful encounter with tears in our eyes. So that Amen. Is the way the Lord works in so yeah. many beautiful aspects.
I also want to recognize Margie. She's also one of our team, and she does a fantastic job when she is there.
And you know she's there because somebody came to church and expected to see Margie in the media room one Sabbath. They came in to bring something for Margie and said, "Where's Margie?" And I said, "Well, you know, COVID." And they were like, "No, but Margie should be here." And I was like, "No." So in a way, Margie is there. And I bet you a lot of people think that everybody is there.
Well, I miss being there, but I haven't got the green light yet. I don't know if you're going to let me come back very soon. And the kids are doing such a good job. It's not like anybody needs me down there. It's just a neat place to be.
One Sabbath morning, I left without Faith because she stayed up the Friday night before with some friends who came by. And also I had most of the work already done. So I said, I think I could do without her. And when she woke up, she was so upset. She called me, she said, "Dad, you left without me." and not only that, but throughout the week, she was like, "Dad, what day is it today?" I said, "Well, it's Tuesday." She said, "You know, since I didn't come to church on Sabbath, I don't even know what day of the week it is anymore."
It's a real empty feeling on Sabbath morning when I'm not in the media center.
Yes. Before we go into the scripture from tonight, is there any other thoughts that you may want to share?
Well, I got a very pleasant surprise Sunday morning, or actually Sabbath afternoon, when I opened my online Sabbath school lesson and realized that the next quarter is Isaiah.
Isaiah, right?
Because I didn't know what we were going to be studying, and I've been reading that a little bit on my own. Mm. And I was just so encouraged that mm-hmm. we'll be reading that wonderful book for the next quarter. Mm. So thank you, Lord.
Yes, look forward to the study of the book of Isaiah. It's powerful. I think it's one of the deepest books in the Old Testament. Mm-hmm. Each one of them is beautiful, but Isaiah, I think it's one of those pivotal points in the scripture that is like a bridge connecting the Old Testament and the New Testament from the perspective of the Old Testament. And if I'm not mistaken, I think it's one of the most quoted books of the Old Testament by New Testament writers.
Mm-hmm. And by Ellen White. If anyone studies the Sabbath school lesson online, if you have a chance, look at the video that's posted. I think it's by the Pacific. I can't remember who made the video, but it talks about it talks about Isaiah 1:18. Mm-hmm. And come, let us reason together. Is that 18? Mm-hmm. Anyway,
why don't you send me a link with that video, and then I will post it online on the website. And so everybody who goes to the website, there will be a link with that video on the website.
Okay. I think you'll really enjoy it.
I just wanted to share that my granddaughter Faith got me. Can you read that, what it says?
God is love.
Yes, God is love. And it's like, it's a keychain, but I put it on my cell phone. Mm-hmm. And I just shared it with everyone. So I'm just so blessed that my granddaughter knows God is love. Mm-hmm. So praise I need to start showing this to everyone I come across so they can remember God is love. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Welcome, Simon. It's good to see you.
Oh, yeah.
It is not good to not hear you. Now we could hear you. Go ahead.
I'm here changing my name.
Lucci. Lucci.
Well, the topic for tonight stems from a Instagram post that I came across a while ago, well, a few days ago, that says, nothing like opening your Christmas gifts to remind you that the people you're closest in the world know absolutely nothing about you. And I know I must be the only person who had experienced that. All of you have not ever experienced that kind of reality. The other thing that ignited the topic for tonight was an encounter that I had with my son Caleb, which I will tell you as we go through this study. But first, let's read the passage from tonight, which comes from the book of Genesis. This is one of the oldest stories in the Bible, besides the story of the Garden of Eden. This is the very first story of our world, the way we know it today. And if we would have a volunteer who would be so kind to read this passage, I would really appreciate it.
I can read it, Lourdes. Adam made love to his wife, Eve, and she became pregnant and gave birth to Cain. She said, with the help of the Lord, I have brought forth a man. Later, she gave birth to his brother, Abel. Now Abel kept flocks and Cain worked the soil. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. And Abel also brought an offering, fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering, he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. Then the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it. Now Cain said to his brother Abel, let's go out to the field. While they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is your brother Abel? I don't know, he replied. Am I my brother's keeper? The Lord said, what have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you are under a curse and driven from the ground, which opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it will no longer yield its crops for you. You will be a restless wanderer on the earth. Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is more than I can bear. Today you are driving me from the land and I will be hidden from your presence. I will be a restless wanderer on the earth and whoever finds me will kill me. But the Lord said to him, not so. Anyone who kills Cain will suffer vengeance seven times over. Then the Lord put a mark on Cain so that no one who found him would kill him. So Cain went out from the Lord's presence and lived in the land of Nod, east of Eden.
Thank you so much, Elder. This is, as I mentioned before, the very first story of the world as is now. Well, if you want, pre-flood world. But this is the first story outside of the garden. What do you see in this story?
I see that even though Cain sinned terribly, killing his brother, the Lord had compassion on him. I noticed here, so that no one would kill him, he protected him, mm-hmm. even though he sinned terribly. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to make sense of that. Mm. I've often wondered about it.
It seems that Cain was so unaware of the horror of what he had done that he had the nerve to confront God and saying, oh, my punishment is too much. In other words, he throws an accusation at God and saying, you are too harsh. And of course, that is a familiar, has a familiar ring to it, because it's exactly what Lucifer accused God of being: harsh, arbitrary, cruel. Cain was reflecting that very attitude, and even despite that, as Ted points out, the Lord was willing to reduce his sentence.
Yeah, it's a repeating theme in scripture. When you look at those who end up siding with Satan and rejecting the mercy of God, that the one common trait is this whole idea of self-justification. Instead of, and you can see the difference certainly with Saul and David. Saul justifies his actions. David says, you know, I've done horrible wrong here. You're right in what you've said, Lord. But the other thing here is this whole, you know, thing with sin. You know, capital punishment was not instituted till after the flood, and I think God, you know, allowed Cain to live to show what happens when you don't deal with wrongdoing. Just the horrible fruitage. I mean, eventually the world became so wicked because of the descendants of Cain that God, the only way to salvage the world was to send the flood. But throughout here, it really does come through so strong that the mercy and the graciousness of God.
Well said. Any other observations that you may be able to see here? What jumps at you? What speaks to you?
Well, one thing I've always wondered about, and as I sit here and think about it, this was before, as far as we know, this was before it's recorded that God set up the sacrificial system.
Right.
Israel. And so one wonders how much were Cain and Abel aware of what was a acceptable offering by God.
That's a good point, Marge. A lot of times we look at the Old Testament and in trying to gain an understanding of the timeline, yes, we arrive at the book of Exodus, and it's only then when we see an organized procedure of the sacrificial system. But who was the first one who offered the first sacrifice?
God.
When?
When Adam and Eve sinned and he slaughtered the first lamb or sheep for their clothing.
Right. So Adam and Eve knew exactly their way back into the garden. In his wisdom, God had revealed to them that it was the wages of sin was death, and that he was the one to offer that sacrifice. And so there's an expectation that both Cain and Abel were well educated and have a thorough understanding of what the consequence of sin was. Even God talks to him in very plain words here, right? It says, sin is crouching at your door, right there.
Christian.
Go ahead, Dan.
I wonder, excuse me, I wonder if what Cain is thinking or saying is that by saying it's this punishment more than I can bear, he's saying this is a punishment that's worse than death. Mm-hmm. The idea that he will be a wanderer, a restless wanderer, and hidden from God's presence through the rest of his life, and no one dare kill him. No, there's no one dare giving him the ultimate punishment. But I wonder he was just saying, yeah, this is much worse than if you had killed me, because I'm separated now from God.
Mm. What does the rest of the group think about this observation?
You mean Dan's observation or another observation?
Yes, Dan's observation with regard to the interpretation of punishment versus death.
It says right there, I will be hidden from your presence. That was worse than death.
And yet, it's Cain that moves away. Somebody once, I read from somebody once that if you look at the one, if you look through the book of Genesis, it's usually the ones that are not receiving the covenant blessings that move away.
True. Specified, Martha. I was talking to somebody today about how in the story of the prodigal son, he is the one that goes away. The father keeps waiting. Moreover, the father comes to welcome him. The father makes the first step towards receiving the son back. Good observation.
Something else here.
Go ahead, Doris.
Looks like Cain learned well from his father blaming God for something else. When God came to the garden and said, where are you? You know, what did you do to Adam? He said, that's the wife, the woman you gave me.
Mm-hmm.
And now he learned well, it's called, apples and fall far from the tree. Huh?
Mm-hmm.
So if he was trained, he comes out and says, what is it? When the sacrifice wasn't accepted, and he said, well, where is your brother's? What am I, my brother's keeper?
Mm-hmm.
I think this is kind of a blame somebody else for what you did and try to escape your own consequences type of a thing. And that seems like a whole lot easier than to face, well, yeah, I did wrong, and yes, I got to ask for forgiveness, and yes, I got to confess, and, all that we need to do, not so much a ritual, but so that the consequences are here. It talks about the punishment is really matched with our choice, and I think the fact that he tried to usurp his own responsibility, that he really went overboard and killed, it gives me pause to think, well,
When I go through these consequences, it's because of what I have done, and should I have known better? And you made the comment, they were well educated or they were well taught. So we learn, we're well taught, but then we still make choices. That's kind of what I see here.
What you're saying, Doris, is so powerful and so deep. In my ministry, I've had a few opportunities to deal with couples who have betrayed each other. And as you were speaking, I was trying to revisit some of those cases, and I still cannot identify a case in which they came and the guilty party said, I'm guilty. I've had cases when a person even came with a PowerPoint presentation to show how the victim was actually at fault. You may laugh because you find it, you know, very ridiculous, but it's a crushing reality. It's a crushing reality. And I have seen it more than once when not only the person who is at fault refuses to acknowledge their mistake, they make it somebody else's mistake. They blame it on others. And that is, as the English language says, adding insult to injury, I guess the word is.
So what we see here with Cain is there's no repentance. There's no remorse and no repentance. There's only anger.
Well said, Marge. And yes, it lines up exactly with what Doris said. There was no repentance with Adam and Eve either. At no time, not before, not during, not after their encounter with God, had they acknowledged their sin. They left, as in my people back home say, with their tail between their legs, they left the garden and never looked back.
I wonder how they felt, and did Cain ever go back and see his parents after that? But I think that's part of the banishing of his. It's like, no, you can't go back and ever see them again. Kind of like, I just got to say that, you know, for what I didn't say in a half hour ago, I was telling Dan recently about the isolation. Mm-hmm. Well, if anybody sees me now, you know, what will I do? The isolation, I don't think is a punishment. It's just, I think it's a way of making you focus. Either you're going to pay attention or you're going to get out of Dodge. That's just the bottom line. And God wants us to either pay attention or, you know, step aside so somebody else can, you know, you won't be an impediment. And I do, yeah, I don't mean to, you know, say that this doesn't show that it's God's love. I'm going to just take it for granted. God loves us. He gave his son. And that's understood. Mm-hmm. But it's that process of trying to get out of confessing or accepting or just doing and just shutting up and just say, God, I need help. I just messed up again. And I may not have killed somebody with a blood shedding, but I could have very well killed. And I know I killed a lot of people in my lifetime with my little tongue. And so this reminds me of, he may have killed physically. We go, oh, well, this guy got a gun or a knife or a club. Mm-hmm. What did we say to kill somebody's spirit?
I crossed that, Doris, because you said that's not a punishment. And that was the point I was going to make last, but I'm glad that you brought it up. That indeed was not a punishment. That's what Cain says is a punishment. But what was in reality?
Consequence of his exactly. actions.
Exactly. That was a consequence of sin. You see, mm-hmm. you see how twisted his mind was? Even the consequence of his actions, he attributes to who?
To God.
To God. Mm-hmm. He says, it's you who are bringing about all of this stuff. That was not a punishment instituted by God. And to prove that that was not a punishment, what does God do next?
Protects him.
Mark on him. Mm-hmm.
He protects him. He puts a mark on him. He seals him. We find this concept of sealing somebody in what other book of the scriptures?
Revelation.
The Revelations. What chapter?
Is that... I don't know, 13 or...
Or the context.
Chapter 7.
Thank you, Martha, right? The 144,000, right?
Oh, that's right.
Those are the ones who are sealed by God. And God puts his seal here, his mark, on a murderer. Who does that?
Only God. That's profound.
And Martha mentioned it before. It was not God who walked away. The Bible says it very clearly. Last verse here. He went out. It was his decision to leave God. And you know what? This Cain sits in front of a camera right now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, Pastor Chris, and I keep thinking, how much does our ego come between us and God?
Mm-hmm. A whole bunch.
Because Cain, I see some level of ego in him. And like, hey, it's not me, it's the other person, right? He did this, that is why I did that. So recently I was reading a book and the whole emphasis is, instead of you saying, who did it? Begin to think of how can I better the situation that it puts you in a better frame of mind to own up, to be accountable to any situation you find yourself in, instead of looking for somebody that did something wrong. So if Cain would have pulled back his ego and like, hey God, I messed up, I think the story would have ended differently.
Mm-hmm. That is a very powerful point, Simon. And for any one of you who would like to start the new year with a good reading, mm-hmm. I would point you back to the book Patriarchs and Prophets. I've been drawing such a great deal of inspiration from it. And I don't know how many times I read it, but every single time I read it, I'm like, wow, you know, starting with the chapters, the first chapters that describe the beginning of the great controversy. In the chapter about Cain and Abel, let me see if I could paste this so you will see it yourself. That spirit of pride actually is at the heart of this whole thing from the very beginning. Would you read that for us, Simon, the text I just pasted?
Of chapter 4, verse
1. It's right here at the bottom.
Okay. Cain came before God with murmuring and infidelity in his heart in regard to the promised sacrifice and the necessity of the sacrificial offerings. His gift expressed no penitence for sin. He felt, as many now feel, that it will be an acknowledgement of weakness to follow the exact plan marked out by God.
of trusting his salvation wholly to the atonement of the promised Savior.
That points out that he did not want to give up something that was special to him. So a lamb was special to him either by way of what he could have gotten for it, the value of it. He was not giving up what he needed to give up. That's what that tells me.
Well said, Doris, with one footnote there. What he wasn't willing to give up was not a thing, was self. In this very passage that I just highlighted here and underlined, verses 2 to 5, this is the beginning of the theology of works versus theology of grace. It started back then. Cain brought a gift that he thought should atone for himself. And in doing so, rendered God's plan as futile. And look at God, verse 6. I could only imagine God, right? The Bible doesn't go into details. It's more of a schematics, right? But when I read verses 6 and 7, God comes to him and he's like, come on, boy, what's happening? What are you doing? Why are you angry? I mean, you know what's right, what's not right, you know? Do what's right and things will be just fine. But if you keep in your stubbornness, sin is right there, ready to pounce on you, ready to corrupt you like a virus, right? It's like dealing with COVID-19. If you play with it, you will get infected and it will take you down. He says you must rule over it. You must keep that social distancing. You must, you know, not play with that. Come on. God doesn't admonish Cain for his pride. You know, he doesn't like go into a lecture with him. He's just very kindly trying to bring him back, to redirect him, to point out that God is the source of forgiveness. God is the source of healing for him. He's like, don't do it your way, because it doesn't work like that.
For me, it's such an act of God's love that he even bothers to have these conversations with people like the rebellious parents of Cain and all the rest of the people that he has dialogues and conversations with. Why does God bother? But it's because he loves. And, you know, every passage in scripture is just drenched in God's love, particularly through these conversations. The Lord didn't have to talk to Cain at all. But he did, because he wanted to redeem him. He wanted to rescue him. And so he kept, you know, he didn't ask one question, he asked several, and maintained a conversation with him, with a person who was not interested. But the Lord was right there. Let me ask you another question, and say one more thing to you. And that's God. That's God.
Cain was God's firstborn son from human beings. God has many sons. Jesus is God's son, God himself. Lucifer was God's first created son. Adam and Eve were the first ones created in God's image. And Cain is the first anatomically born son. I could only imagine the happiness in God's heart when Cain was born. He says to us, if you who are evil know how to treat your kids, how much more the Father? If Eve was happy when she was blessed with a son, how much more the Father? I could only imagine how patient and how gracious God was with Cain. And in that, I see how God is with me. I told you the thought for this topic came this week in a conversation with my son, Caleb. He was given a Christmas gift. And I had a feeling he was not gonna like it. It came from a lovely family member, but I know Caleb very well, and I knew he was not gonna like that gift. And he opened, peeled just one side, the end side, and he saw what the gift was, and I could see his face downcast, kind of like Cain's face. And I said, what's happening, son? And he said, Dad, what should I do? And I said, what's the matter? He said, first of all, I'm not into these things anymore. Second of all, I have another one from last year. And third of all, I don't know how to say to this person that I like the gift when I don't like it. So I'll cut the story short. I had to sit down with him and say, look, people's feelings are very important, but so is your integrity. We cannot compromise truth. We cannot lie just to make people feel good. But we will do everything we can to make them feel good. So he said, would you please help me? I said, okay. How do you want me to help you? Well, why don't you talk? He said, why don't you talk to this person and use your skills and your wisdom, he said, to make them feel good. But also, don't make me say that I like it. I said, I promise I will not make you say that you like it. Well, I talked to the person and I said, I'm in the process of teaching my son some valuable lessons. I would really appreciate your help, because he is now in that stage of life, he's only 10, when he tries to balance out how to make people happy versus how to be truthful. And the person said he didn't like my present gift, my Christmas gift, right? I didn't have to say any more after that. In the story of Cain and Abel, Cain brings his own gift and he expects God to lie and pretend that he likes his gift. And God, being the truthful God he is, but also the gracious God he is, he doesn't break Cain's heart. But he doesn't lie to him either. You see, if God would have done something to please Cain, everything he's done for us would have been zero. He would have opened a door to everybody earning their own salvation by just tilling the ground, by just paying a tithe, by just putting in a time for volunteering or whatever. But God says, son, I already did that for you. You just need to acknowledge it. That's all. Don't stress about it. It's okay. You don't need to do it. I've done it for you. Just receive it. And even if he, even after he throws the tantrum and you know, blames God and Abel and everybody else for his issues, God puts a mark on Cain so that no one who found him would kill him. That, my brothers and sisters, is God's immunity. You don't need a bulletproof vest. You don't need any kind of defense when you have God's mark on you. That's powerful. And that's not given to somebody who was obedient and submissive and loving and caring and all of that. No, that was given to the most rebellious, brattiest, proud human being that you could think of in that period of time. And obviously there weren't all that many living around. So he is the chief. And God says, I will protect you. I have had the privilege, just like a few of you, to work with patients who suffer with anxiety disorders. And I cannot tell you how many times our anxieties stem from a pile of junk that we've deposited over the course of our life and never surrendered to God. I'm not dismissing anxiety when it's about a neurochemical imbalance in our brain. No. So don't take this to an extreme where someone may say, well, pray over it and everything will be solved with that. No. But I am talking about those state of minds and of hearts that are so accentuated by things that we never bother to surrender to the Lord. But somehow we thought we could deal with it. Somehow we trusted the skill of our hands and the labor and the knowledge that we have to deal with it. And it only added to this restlessness, because that's what it is. The Bible says it there. I will be restless wanderer on the earth. And I will no longer be able to establish healthy relationships because people who will find me will kill me. That is the consequence of going against God's plan. I was reading an article probably a month ago about a ultra rich person, a multimillionaire guy, who paid a poor family a lot of money to let him spend Christmas with them. True story, not made up, not a movie. True story. And at the heart of that was a profound sense of disconnect. He was so thirsty and so desperate for connection that he paid and he selected. He had a process of, you know, selecting the families and pay them handsomely. But he said, I wanted at least for once to feel what it means to be in a loving home. The consequence of sin separating from God brings about that restlessness and wandering over the entire surface of the earth, trying to find connections and never settling. That's what adultery is. Just like alcoholism, adultery is a symptom of a deeper problem. People trying to connect with others when there's an emptiness inside. And it doesn't work with one, and they try with another and another and another. It doesn't work. Until they come to a point and say, I'm alive because God's mark is on me. I live in the shadow of the cross. That is the guarantee of why I'm alive today. I believe that the mark that God put on Cain was the power of his death and resurrection, was the power of the cross, was the ultimate sacrifice. That is the only thing that keeps us alive. It's the sacrifice of Christ. And I don't know that God tattooed a cross where he put whatever kind of mark or inscription on him, but I know that the power stemmed directly from the loving sacrifice of Christ, the older brother, who guaranteed the safety and the life of Cain. I see myself tonight in the shoes of Cain. Because I've turned on God so many times. I blamed God for my own mistakes. I washed my hands so proudly so many times, dismissing anything that I did as normal. And time and again, even as I went out from God's presence, he followed me, he chased me, he sealed me with his presence, with his mark. He waited for me to come back. I was talking to a lovely sister of ours who comes from a Jewish background. And every time I talk to her, my heart is refreshed. She's up in her age, and with the age, of course, there comes certain liabilities. And if somebody contracts COVID, as Rita and Jivika testified, one who may be younger could recover faster. One who may be older may take longer or even worse. And in talking to this dear sister of ours, I shared how not only the guarantee of life, of current life, is such a beautiful gift from God, but also the peace and the assurance that the ending of our life is just as pleasant and beautiful and accepting in God's sight as our life is. So there's nothing for us to fear as we look into the future. Even as Cain went out from the presence of the Lord, he didn't know where he was going to go. He had no Google Maps. He had no charts, nothing. He just goes. But he was bearing the mark that God put on him. And so you may be concerned about COVID, or you may be concerned about 2021. We've already seen what 2020 brought, and realistically, I don't have any expectations from 2021 other than God's presence. And as long as he is there, I don't care. There could be earthquakes, fires, hail, hell, whatever, name it. I don't care. And after we have a moment of prayer and talk with God, I would like to share with you an old song that states just that powerful promise about God and the future. As we join the meeting tonight, a few of you have already shared a few prayer requests. We have Brother Eddie Matu in the hospital, and then Ted's brother Robert, who's also diagnosed with COVID and is in isolation, and due to some other conditions that he has, being in a nursing home, he's isolated and very lonely and very depressed, crying every time he talks to Ted. These two lovely brothers are on our list of prayer for tonight. Please bring any other mentions that you may have.
I have two families at PHA, one that's COVID positive, and I have another family that's going through some, the student is having some medical problems, And I want to keep both of these families in prayer. I didn't get permission to mention their names, but that's I will ask.
Yeah, for me, it's more of prayer of thanks. I know for 2 or 3 weeks now, I've not been on this platform. Reason being that I got in touch with COVID. So on the 18th of December, I got positive. And well, for three days, it was really, really, really hard, cold and all the rest of it. But before the end of the week, I was okay. So yesterday I did another screening and the result came back today as okay. So I don't have the virus in me anymore for now.
Praise God.
So, and the kids as well, everybody got screened. I'm still waiting for their results to come in. So I just want to thank God. If it's not in me, sure, nobody at home will have it. Let's continue to pray for our brothers and sisters out there in the front line, helping the sick.
Thank you, Simon, and praise the Lord for the healing that he's produced in you.
Amen.
Dr. Glenelle Clark is very ill. I think he's at Redlands Hospital. I understand it's bleeding in the brain. So that's what was shared with us elders. So want to keep him and his wife married.
And even some prayer. Paralysis, correct?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Did you have a fall or something? Or just an aneurysm?
I'm really not sure of the details, but and he has a history. He's been ill before, very ill. And so we just have to pray that the Lord will be with him.
Thank you, Elder.
That's tough.
I remember seeing him in church. He would sit across the aisle from me, and I would see him massaging his legs during church service. So I wondered if there was a circulatory issue.
Anyone else?
I have a cousin that's now battling with cancer. So besides this COVID virus, cancer has been up on that top list for a lot of people in this world. I just pray for those that are going through that.
Absolutely.
The request last week that I made, Pastor, for a friend of ours, we learned today she's going to speak with the oncologist tomorrow. So we're praying that they'll come up with a game plan that will maybe be good outcome. The results will be good.
Excellent. Good. Any other requests before we go into a session of prayer?
Pastor, just for protection for Shehan, Shamel, and Lilu. Since it's like they're in the battlefields. Two COVID positive patients and isolated in rooms, but they had to keep us hydrated, feeding and all that.
Absolutely.
That's hard.
Yes.
Anyone else? I'm going to go around and with your permission, I would like to invite you to pray specifically. So, Simon, would you be kind to pray for Jivika's family? As you've heard, Jivika recovered just like you from COVID, but he, just like you, has a family at home who is in need of protection. Especially Shehan with an immunity that needs a special attention there. Thank you, Simon. And Glenda, would you be kind to pray for Simon's family, please?
Sure.
All right. And Ted, would you be kind to pray for Glenda's friend and the visit with the oncologist? We cannot hear you, Ted.
Did we have a name?
I don't feel free to give the name right now. I'm sorry.
That's fine.
All right. Thank you very much, Ted. And Margie, would you be kind to pray for Rita's cousin who's dealing with cancer?
Yes.
Thank you. Dan and Doris, would you be kind to pray for Ted's brother, Robert, who is in the nursing home dealing with COVID?
Yes.
Either one of you, thank you so much. Sister Sherry, would you be kind to pray for Elder Glenel Clark, who's in the Redlands Hospital?
Glenel Bark, is that
Clark?
Clark.
Oh, Clark. Okay, sure.
Thank you, Sherry. And Martha, would you be kind to pray for the two families at Charmel's Precious Hearts Academy who are dealing with COVID?
Yes.
Thank you. And Sister Lourdes, would you be kind to pray for Eddie Matu, please?
Uh-huh. Okay.
Yes. And let's see. All right. And the ones who haven't had assigned anything, please pray as the Spirit impresses your heart to pray. And I'll be the last one to conclude with a prayer from here. Please don't forget to unmute yourself before praying.
Heavenly Father, thank you, God, for the blessings and the wisdom and walking us through challenges. Mm. Thank you for 2020. Mm-hmm. Even though it was a rough year, you taught us lessons, moved us closer to you. Mm. Please be with the church families who's having health challenges right now, mm-hmm. and give them the healing hands. Continue to hold their hands and walk through these challenges. And thank you for all the opportunities given to us in the year 2020. Mm-hmm. Even though it's a rough year, we learned a lot. And thank you for that. Please be with us as if we stepping on to 2021. Mm-hmm. Like Pastor Christian said, we have no fear. Mm-hmm. Thank you for your love. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Our dear gracious Heavenly Father, I want to pray especially for the two families, Lord, in Precious Hearts Academy. Be with the family if they're struggling with COVID, Lord. We ask for healing. And you know the challenges and you know alone what they're going through. Please draw their hearts to you, Lord, to see that you love them, that you have a plan for their lives and for their children, and you are going to make everything new one day very, very soon. We thank you for all the testimonies that were shared tonight and for your answering prayers, Lord. We ask for increased faith, that we will trust you more. We thank you for your love for us and for your precious promises. You've said that you have plans for us and that you have promised to give us a future and a hope. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask that you be with Elder Clark. Apparently he's in the hospital with some type of a bleeding issue, possibly in his brain. Lord, you are the ultimate physician, and you are able to heal him, care for him, support him and his family. We ask that you intervene, if that's your will, Lord. Thank you for this meeting this evening, Lord, and the message that Pastor Jordan gave. Ask these things in your holy name. Amen.
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 So God, I want to say thank you so much for the privilege you've given us to be alive today. It's not by our own making, it's not by our own power. But your word tells us by this of your mercies that we are not consumed. Thank you because you are such a loving God that is always there to uphold us, to strengthen us, to protect us. Father, upon this promise, I lift up Shamir and Jamaica's family unto your able hand, especially for Shahan, knowing his situation in relation to vulnerability to infection. Lord, I just pray, because your word tells us that those who trust in you will take refuge under the shadow of your wings. I pray, Father, that Shahan will be adequately protected and covered under the shadow of your wings.
Yes.
Even as we go through this time, even as we go through this condition created by COVID, I pray, Father, that you will seal him just like we've learned this evening. Seal him, Lord, that he will be protected. And for the rest of the family, Lord, as Shamel recovers from the COVID, I pray, Father, for strength as well. Be with Jibika as well. Pray that your love and your grace will comfort and empower them. Thank you, Father, because you're such a loving God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
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 Father, we thank you that as a group, we can come before you as believers in you, believing that you will answer our prayers as we ask in your name. Lord, we want to remember special tonight, along with all these other petitions that you, for somehow will have blessings on the Glenda's friend who is going to see the oncologist. Lord, we pray that things will work out positive to your glory and honor. Lord, we thank you that you have given us, as sinful beings, you've given us an alternative to where we can see you face to face someday when you come in the clouds. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Lord, I want to thank you for this evening's meeting. Thank you for the passage that we looked at and thought about. And you have revealed yourself as a loving God beyond anything that we can imagine or even think. And we want to have that love for each other. We want to have that love for you, And we just thank you that we have brothers and sisters of like faith that can gather together and praise your name and thank you for everything that you are in our lives. This evening, we think of Eddie Matu, and we thank you for the way you have guided in his life. He has seen miracles happen in his life. And so, Lord, we thank you because we trust you that you're going to be with him in this new crisis that he is facing. And we just thank you, Lord, for each person that has given their testimony this evening that has strengthened us. And we thank you that where two or three are gathered, your spirit is there. And we have felt your spirit here tonight. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we raise up tonight Rita's cousin. We pray, Lord, that you are with this person. Stand beside them. Lord, we ask that because you know us so well, because you are our maker and you have a great physician, that you reach inside and destroy this cancer that is destroying this person. We ask, Lord, that you guide the hands of the healthcare professionals who are caring for Rita's cousin. We thank you, Lord, that we can depend on you to be in our lives every day. We ask that you give us the strength to be weak, to lean on you, to depend upon you, Lord, because you are our only salvation. Lord, we thank you for this prayer meeting, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you with thanksgiving and praise for your healing touch, particularly upon Ted's brother, Robert, as he's dealing with COVID. You know his condition. And we also pray for Ted. This gives him support and his love for his brother. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Heavenly Father, thank you. I thank you for all my brothers and sisters. And as I pray for those unbelievers, the ones that are not connected with you, family members, friends, neighbors, acquaintance, just completely always praying for them that they may see you and know that Jesus died on the cross, our joy, our salvation, and the Holy Spirit to dwell within them so that they can see your beloved Son, Jesus Christ. I thank you, Heavenly Father. Amen.
Amen.
Dear Father, we thank you for the study that we have had this evening and the opportunity to study your word. Lord, we have so much to be thankful for. Lord, we are happy to hear about the recoveries of Jivika and Simon. Mm-hmm. And Rita, who are recovering from this awful COVID. Mm-hmm. Lord, we know that we are all subjects to get it, and we need to protect ourselves. And we, Lord, we pray that you will bless Simon's family tonight, that they will be kept safe as he is still recovering and in isolation. Lord, we depend so much on you and all your goodness to us. We ask that you be with each and every one of us, guide us in our daily lives, help us to represent you in all that we do and say. Thank you for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Dear Heavenly Father, in the midst of all of this uncertainty, we are certain about one thing, and that is your love for us as your people. Amen. Lord, I want to just echo the words of the others who have spoken tonight and lift your healing hands upon those who are sick, those who are lonely, those who are in pain. Lord, we want you to come soon because I can see no other solution but you. Please be with those in the world who still have not seen you in the midst of all of this agony. Help them to open their eyes and to know that your love is everlasting and that your protection is permanent. And give them that chance for salvation. Thank you so much for your blessings. Thank you for being our anchor and our shield. And thank you for giving us strength to face another day, another week, and this new year to come. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Lord, what a wonderful God you are to all of us. You're amazing. Even as we look back, we could only attest that had it not been for your hand, none of us would be here tonight.
That's right.
And Lord, our rebellion brought about all of this, which we're dealing with today. You have nothing to do with anything evil in this world. And yet many times we just blamed you straight up for our own mistakes and our own wrongdoings. And all along, you have put this mark of your son's loving sacrifice on all of us. It is by your grace and by your own wounds that we are healed today.
Amen.
Yeah, stop.
As we look forward now, Lord, in the 2021, which is just another measurement of time, nothing else. As we look into this future, we could only rest on the grace that we have seen in the past. We have grieved in 2020 and before, and you were there with us. We've lost dear family members, and you were there with us. We've experienced tremendous pain and grief and depression and despair sometimes, and you were right there with us. You are with us here and now. We went through changes of heart. We went through revelations of things that we've never known before. And it was all because of you, Lord, that our eyes were open, that our hearts were touched, that our life was transformed. And as we look into 2021, we know not what the future holds, but we know who holds the future.
Amen.
And that's enough for us. And we thank you, Lord, for being our God, and we love you. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I told you I wanted to share with you a song. It is an oldie, some of you might have been around when it was first sang. What touched me was especially the refrain, which says just this: I know not what the future holds, but I know who holds the future. It's a secret known only to him.
I know not what the future holds, but I know who holds the future. It's a secret known only to him. In this world of fear and doubt, on my knees I ask the question, why a lonely heavy cross I must bear? Then he tells me in my prayer, it's because I am trustworthy. He gives me strength far more than my share. No, only to him are the great hidden secrets. I'll fear not the darkness when my flame shall dim. I know not what the future holds, but I know who holds the future. It's a secret known only to him.
Only to him.
Well, my friends, with that in mind, I invite you to take on this 2021. As we approach that threshold of time. And I don't know about the cultures where you come from, but in the culture that I grew up, on New Year's Eve, we would go to church and there would be a promise that each one of us would have on a bookmark. There would be a plate that would be passed around and each one of us would pick a promise for the year. Obviously, we're separated by time, by space, but not by time. And when you have a moment, I would like for you to go to the Book of Psalms, not right now, but after we conclude this meeting. And I would like for you to look at Psalms chapter 59, verse 16. That is 59, verse 16. 1:6, as a promise for what lies ahead of us in 2021. So that is the Book of Psalm, chapter 59, verses 1:6. So 16, 1:6. Psalm 59:16. When you may be in doubt, when you may be a little questioning what the future holds, this beautiful psalm encapsulates everything about the past, the present, and the future. May the Lord bless you, and we'll see you next year.
Yes. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Good night, all.
Good night.
Good night. Happy New Year. Bye-bye.